Leviticus 1, verse 14. We'll read 14 to the end of the chapter. And if the burnt sacrifice for his offering to the Lord be of fowls, then he shall bring his offering of turtle doves or of young pigeons. And the priest shall bring it unto the altar, and wring off its head, and burn it on the altar. And the blood thereof shall be wrung out of by the side of the altar, and he shall pluck away its crop with its feathers, and cast it beside the altar of the east part by the place of the ashes. And he shall cleave it with the wings thereof, but shall not divide it asunder. And the priest shall burn it upon the altar, upon the wood that is upon the fire. It is a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, of a sweet savor unto the Lord. In the case of doves, the role of the priest and offerer were very different, and we've pointed that out over and over, from offering a bull or a lamb. It says, the poor offer two turtle dove or two young pigeons. This refers to the poor of in understanding. The poverty involved with the doves is that we do not fully share with the Father on what pleases him. We don't know the parts. We don't know the intimacy. We don't know the inward parts. We don't know, you see what I'm saying? And so the doves are, and the young pigeons, there's no really dividing and getting into it and holding up the different parts and examining them. And in fact, I don't know if you noticed, but the priest does almost everything in this case. Jesus, our high priest, does it all for us. But you see, that's good, he does it for us. But the truth is, it just shows that we're poor in spirit, poor in understanding, that is, of understanding what the cross and what fellowship and with him in it involves. To whatever degree we know Christ in his death is the degree we are involved with him. If we are poor in knowledge, then someone else does the main work in our stead. And this can be the case. You can be involved around here. You can be involved in the Bible school or the church, and someone else may be doing a whole lot of the studying for you. They may be doing a lot more praying for you than you're doing. They, or in the case of the Lord, we're just believing in what he did for us. And there's nothing other than an acknowledgement through that sacrifice that acknowledges his work. But it never enters into it in faith or in experience, because these offerings are about your experience of Christ and your ability to fellowship with him. Can you fellowship with him in these things? You know, and there's a difference between going through something, having a bad spirit, and going through something with him and fellowshipping with him. You know, you can just have a bad spirit about something and you're not fellowshipping with him, you know. Have you ever been around somebody who wanted to share the Lord and you wanted to share the Lord, but you were doing good and everything else and they just had a bad spirit? And you just kind of, you're trying to share and it's like, you know. For example, I know people that believe in what we preach, but the main thing that they talk about is not our death with Christ or Christ living in us. The main thing they talk about is that we broke with the church system and there's something wrong with the church system and all the people are wrong that are in the church system and everything's bad and the whole world's going to hell, you know, being FedEx there or something, you know. And which is quite a bit faster than a handbasket. and you get this sort of, I've fellowshiped with them, but I feel dirty when I leave because their whole thing isn't Christ. I'll give you another example. One time I went to Ireland. I don't think you were there at this. Well, no, I think you were. No, you. But speaking to the Irish here. But there was a man that I had Michael Finnegan gave me his book. And each chapter had something. And one chapter was about Christ's life, and another one was about being in Christ, and another one was about the cross, and another one was about something else. And it was really good. And the last chapter was about that you didn't meet in church buildings, you met in homes. And to meet in a church building was sort of like the great harlot or something. That the New Testament church met in homes. So if we're not meeting in homes, we're, wrong. And this guy, honestly, this book was good. The sharing of Christ and the cross and all this stuff. So he was told, Michael Finnegan said, now we have brothers that believe like you do, and it's going to be a real good time of fellowshipping together. And the guy came all the way from all the way across the island, Dublin, and came to be with us, and when he shared, he didn't mention the cross, he didn't mention Christ's life, he didn't mention fellowship or conformity in death or that we're seated together in heavenly places, he didn't mention union, he didn't mention that we're one with Jesus as bride. The whole time he talked was that you're wrong if you're meeting in buildings. And I was not upset or disappointed in him. I was disappointed that if this brother knew these realities of Christ, I wanted to fellowship with him in Jesus. That's what I was so looking forward to. And I was excited because the way that it was shared in the book, I felt like maybe I could get something from the Lord here. And I'm going to use that as an example. But there are many people who focus on the message of Christ and Him crucified, but they've got some thing in their doctrine that is really more important to them than Christ. And they pound that baby, whether it's meeting in homes or what was the other example I gave, or, if Jesus isn't coming back or whatever, it doesn't matter. To me, I'll just say it publicly, to me, Jesus is more important than any of those things. Jesus, right now, I could care less if, somebody meets in a building. And, it occurs to me, Paul met with the Ephesians for 3 years in a school building. I'm sure Paul's in hell right now. I could care less if Jesus is coming back or not coming back. When it comes to the emphasis of Christ, Christ is what's important to me. And people, and people get upset with me. Why don't you jump on the bandwagon? There ain't no bandwagon. Jesus is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the length and the breadth and the height and the depth. And you go ride your little bandwagon and try to get everybody to jump on it. Woo-hee! You got seven people going, woo-hee! I mean, it's just ridiculous to me. I'm going after the Lord. And I'm not, and let me make it clear. I'm not against those people. I am not anti anything. I'm pro Jesus. I'm not anti church system or whatever in the sense. It's, I often think of that. I mean, they go, oh, those people are all going to hell. They're messed up. I wouldn't darken the door of a church, man. Oh, they're all, this and that and stuff. And I thought, we're just a little group of people here. If we're ever going to go fishing, it's in that pond we're going to have to fish. Or, unsaved people. But, I was once there, and I've now, And I tell you what, it's only the grace of God if I know anything, and it doesn't make me better than anybody else. It doesn't make me better. It makes Jesus bigger, hopefully. It makes Jesus bigger in my life, but that didn't make me bigger. And I still need Jesus. And it took me a while to come to a revelation of Christ. And it may be years before they see Jesus. But if they have a heart for him, then they'll see Jesus. But you know what? Let me just say this. You can believe in the sin offering and not have a clue about the sweet savor offerings and still be saved. You say, then why are you sharing all this stuff? Because it's in the Bible, because the sin offering is about me and my desire to not, you know, save my wretched rear. Oh, wretched rear that I, sorry. God, I'm always in trouble anyway, you know. You know, I say trouble follows me because I throw bait out all the time. But I mean, you know, I mean, the sin offering is all about me, saving me from hell, making me happy in heaven, making sure that I'm secure for eternity. It's all about me. And yeah, you can receive that sin offering and just live your whole life for you, but thank God for Jesus. But I came to a place after, it's like once I got saved and I got assurance of salvation and I was walking pretty good with the Lord, it was like, okay, well, this is settled, you know, what now? And I tell you what, if there's not more, you'll start looking around for something else other than Jesus. Well, there's a lot more, but now it's more of him, less of me, more of his heart, more of seeing the realities that go off in his mind and in his heart compared to what goes off in my mind and my heart. My mind and my heart is all caught up in me and my circumstances and all the junk I'm, you know, worried about. But when I look into his eyes, meaning into his heart, man, it's just like this large room opens up, this huge universe opens up of wonder, because he's so wonderful. And I just don't ever want to stop. And I'm glad. I want to break with the focus on me. And to do that, eventually you have to quit emphasizing the cross as a tool of salvation and start emphasizing it as a tool of discipleship. If any man follow me, let him take up the cross. Right? Isn't that an application of the cross after salvation? Is it not? Take up your cross daily. Is that not an application of how we live? Not just accept the cross for salvation and then not follow Jesus. You know what I mean? In the way, following Jesus, Jesus said, if any man follow me, let him take up his cross. In other words, he never said, follow me without taking up your cross or denying yourself. I mean, am I right or wrong? I mean, I'm just being honest here. There were people that wanted to follow him. He said, no, go on back. You know? But he said to the disciples, drop your nets and follow me. And then he said to the multitude, if any man, anyone, anybody's going to follow me, then they're going to have to do this. Deny yourself, take up the cross, and come after, you know, he said it like this, if any man come after me, because a lot of people say they're following Jesus and they're not, they're coming after him. If any man, because remember he's walking and all these multitudes are coming. I always see this picture of Jesus walking and the multitude about 10 steps back and he takes a few steps and they take a few steps. You know. You know, they're coming after him. But they're not following him. You can't follow him unless you know him. You're coming after him, but it's still you thinking the way you think, rationalizing the way you rationalize, and it's not, and it does not involve the cross, much less on a daily basis. The only involvement of the cross is I'm saved. But that's supposed to be settled at some point. Did you know that? I believe there's this thing called assurance of salvation. Anybody ever heard of it? I believe there's an assurance that you can have. I'm saved. Praise God. I mean, I'm not just at a moment flash in a worship service. Oh, I'm saved. Yeah, you know, like sort of a settled thing. You just go, you know what? That's done. I'm tired of messing with me and worrying about me and trying to make sure I'm secure. I need to get about trying to get some other people secure. You know? Then you start living your life for God and others. Anyway, I'm not supposed to be talking. In the case of the poor, the priest did all the work. To whatever degree we know Christ in his death is the degree that we will be involved with him in the cross. If we are poor in knowledge, then someone else does the main work in our stead. He does not understand, for our understanding enables one to know to know about the slaughter, the skinning, the dividing of the sacrifice, and to know exactly how to offer Jesus to the Father in a manner that satisfies him. And I just want to emphasize that one more time. All the offerings were not random acts by people. They were the Father saying, I want the Son, I want the cross, and I want it like this. Not just, because most Christians, they run around, they say, oh, I think I'll just give up something, or I think I'll go help my neighbor, and all that's fine. But it's not based on random acts of, how about this? It's not based on random acts of kindness. Have you ever heard that thought? Just go do random acts of kindness. Can you imagine? Can you imagine God giving strict orders to Moses, build the tabernacle this way and have the people bring the offerings this way, and then the next high priest that's raised up goes, you know, forget all that. Just go do random acts of kindness. Well, they'd, you know, somebody go walking into the temple, well, I've been being kind today. Whap, God strikes them dead. That's not my son, that's you, you doing random acts of kindness. Well, it was good. See, we always say that. It was good, you know. The picture I got some years ago was, on this side is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Mine. And over here is the tree of knowledge and good and evil. Yours. We usually put tree of knowledge, good and evil, tree of life. Here's my tree. Here's yours. And somebody says, I don't know about theirs. I don't know about them, you know? And someone else says, oh, no. You know, don't put them down, man. They do a lot of good. Are you hearing me? They do a lot of good. So that if you go to their tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they actually have 51% good and only 49% evil on their tree compared to mine, which has only got 42% good and, you know, whatever, 68% evil. Was that? Whatever. I was never good at math, except for remember this, math counts. So it's important. So they're saying, to you, they're saying to you, don't put them down. They do more good than you. Or, don't put them down. They do a lot of good. They have learned to grow their tree of the knowledge of good and evil, their reject tree to God, to produce a lot more good than you're doing. So we need to honor them. God said, do not eat of it, I don't care how what the percentage of is. Right? But see, we get all into that. We get all into, what was it the Lord shared with me this afternoon about righteousness? I probably shouldn't try to even explain this, but it's something personally he's been dealing with me on for a while. Righteousness being in right standing with God, which may mean being accused but not opening your mouth, not justifying yourself, being at peace enough to say, you know, I know the truth and my Father knows the truth, but we judge by right. We say, but that's not right. So they looked at Jesus and they said, well, he healed on the Sabbath, or he didn't, you know, he didn't wash when he was supposed to, and or this and that. He didn't do it right. He didn't do it right. But God is not looking for the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Did you do it right? He's looking for an inner quality. Was thinking, been meditating on this concept of greatness for a while, long while actually, but it's still very much in the forefront of my spirit. What is greatness? It is the ability to take the lower seat and not feel bad about it. It is the ability to continually minister and not be ministered unto. It is, and to do it in the right spirit. It is, I mean, that's really Jesus' definition of greatness. We say someone is great who defeats all of his enemies. But he can't defeat his own pride. He can't defeat his own soul that cries out for recognition. He can't defeat his own flesh that can't stand not to be honored when everyone else, you know, or the person they don't want to be honored is being honored. See, oh no. Alexander the Great, in his 20s, conquered the whole known world. And, you know, ended up crying and whining and dying young because there, you know, his words, there are no more places to conquer. Shut up, whiny boy. There's a whole, you know, there's a whole land on the inside of you. I see people, folks, that can conquer their enemies, but they don't conquer them by Christ. Jesus didn't conquer his enemies by beating them up. He conquered them by dying for them. Jesus didn't conquer his enemies by proving everybody is wrong and that he's right. He was totally right, and he didn't even go about just trying to prove that he's right or that this is the truth. He just died for those who didn't believe it. And these are points of greatness. These are points of rightness with God, and that's what he's looking for. Will you make a mistake? You better believe you'll make a mistake. Will you do something stupid? You will do something stupid. Will you do something wrong? You will do something wrong. Is your heart after having your whole land taken over by Christ? Probably not. Some people are going, you know, they're justifying their sin, and to go this way is not justifying it. It is just admitting that we are not there yet, but before I get through, Christ will have taken over this vessel. That's the goal. That's the heart, you know. Well, anyway, didn't mean to get off on that, but there's a lot more to it that the Lord's just dealing with me over. Let's see. Those who offer the lamb or bull know the details of Christ crucified. The offer are those who are, but if you offer the turtle dove, someone else does it for you, and the offer are those who are not involved in the process of death. They depend on others to know more about the death and execute it. You understand? Because that's what, remember what we just read? The priest did all that. They depend on somebody else to know more and to execute all and somehow cover them. They're poor in understanding. To them, it is not yet practical or personal, but the death is simply knowledge of what someone else did. When offering the two doves, because of poverty of life, all was not burned, though it's still accepted. But it wasn't a whole burnt offering in the sense of everything burned up. It wasn't. The head was taken over, the crop was, the feathers were plucked off. If the poor acknowledge God's side pertaining to the Son and the work of his offering, regardless of how little, then God receives it. In other words, you may be poor in your understanding. There's a difference between being poor in understanding and willingly ignorant. Poor in understanding is you just hadn't got there yet. Willingly ignorant is I'm afraid to get too deep in the Lord, afraid of what it's going to mean, all this kind of stuff. And usually, again, it's the one that's supposed to be crucified that's whining. I'm afraid of, you know. The offerer of dove knows nothing of skinning or of cutting in pieces. They have not been robbed or stripped of outwardly expressing Christ within. And remember, that's what we talked about, that bullock or the lamb was. The skin was pulled off, and you couldn't imagine. Okay. I remember, and some of you probably do too, us going down to Mexico, and we'd go into Monterey sometimes. We'd go to the market down there. How many of you ever did that? Well, there's several of us did that. Anybody ever pass by one of the little shops there, and they had this skin thing hanging up there? You thought it was a dog. You couldn't tell. Anybody remember seeing the full-blown whatever skin hanging up there and flies all over it? And you come up and say, I'd like some of that, and they cut it off. And yeah, I've seen them. I've seen the flies packed on. Anyway, in those cases, that was goat. But if you can imagine, now Jesus is called the Lamb of God. He's not called the Sheep of God. Anybody ever seen a new lamb? They are just as cute as they can be. I mean, a new little lamb is just so stinking cute. They're just cute. Little fuzzy guys, you know? Well, part of your offering, folks, is to offer a lamb. And you skin it completely. Now imagine hanging that skinned lamb up there, and you know, if you remember that goat, any of you that saw it, I mean, you see the blood vessels, and you see the muscles, and you see, and it just looks gross. I mean, folks, it's hanging in one of their restaurants, although there's no screens or anything else. It's just hanging up right there, and you just say, I'd like some of that, and they cut it off, chase the flies away, and cook it up for you, and give it to you, you know? But I'm looking at that going, that's ugly. What is that thing? You know, I mean, I thought it was stomp dog or something. You know, I didn't know what it was. You know, roadkill. I don't know. You know, I can't. Here's my point. I can't tell if it's lamb or dog. And you get skinned, people can no longer see the outward expression of Christ because God limits you in showing him, even though he's there on the inside, he limits you from showing him so that they come to their conclusions, you're dog. You understand? And the turtle dove guy doesn't understand any of that because he doesn't, it's nothing, there's none of that involved. He's never been to a place where God says, I'm going to limit you in showing Christ and you're just going to have to be with me even if they all think you're a dog. They have not been robbed, those who offer turtle dove have not been robbed or stripped of outwardly expressing Christ within. Christ within them has not been withheld from the public eye. There is no examination of the inward parts. so there is no fellowship in his sufferings. He knows the death and may know of the wisdom behind it, the head of the dove. Remember, the head was taken off. You can know of the hidden wisdom, meaning you can understand the cross. But folks, let me just say this. I have been preaching Christ and Him crucified since I was in my early 20s. Around 21 is when I began, you know, not that I've finished, but when I was 21, I began to come to a revelation of Christ. I have been around nothing but people who preach this. I mean, so, you know, I'm beating the fool out of 60 now, you know, getting real close. All of that many years, and I have seen over and over people gather. Over and over, I can name all the places and all of the amounts of people. I have seen people listen to the message of Christ and crucified, believe it, embrace it, love it, read about it. But over and over, without fail, I have seen the day come when God manifests that in their midst by somebody who not just did something wrong and is being punished, but somebody who is not going to be able to express the Lamb outwardly and looks like a dog. And I've seen not spirit-filled, charismatic people, but deeper life people over and over, the majority of them believe the worst and not have any clue that this could pertain to the very things that we were taught. And I've seen them deny the Lord. I've seen them crucify the Lord. I've seen them join in. Jesus said they will kill you thinking that they do God service. I have seen this with deeper life, people that should have known better. But you know what? To them, it was all about right doctrine and believing the right stuff. And it was not worked into them so much so that they could spot Jesus, whether he's got a lamb outward covering or not. That's Jesus. I can tell what Jesus is like. I know how he is. The very fact that he's not opening his mouth, everybody would open their mouth. Everybody would proclaim themselves. Everybody would go to the furthest end to justify themselves and to, you know, at least give a good strong rebuttal. Am I right or wrong? I mean, that's us. We, you know, it's like, oh, I've got to, you know. But somebody on the outside might go, you know what? I think that's Jesus. I need to look at this a little closer. I think the fact that not, you know, the way that they're carrying them, what's going on here is not us. It's not the way human nature is, even though they're skinned and gutted. I think I see the Lamb. Sadly, the only way that we can spot the Lamb is if this little woolly, happy-go-lucky thing comes dancing up chasing butterflies. Oh, it's the Lamb of God. You know, it's got to be gentle Jesus, meek and mild. It's got to be this sweet little Jesus. It can't be this crucified. Paul didn't say, you know, folks, we follow a crucified, rejected man. The world rejected him. They didn't love him. They didn't say this is the best thing that ever happened. They said he's a criminal, put him up there with other criminals. And then we decided to follow him. So consider what I'm saying, because you're really the first group in all these years I've just frankly just said, you know, I've got to just say this. Eventually, somebody's got, you know, it's not going to be all that much longer and I'll be gone. Somebody's got to get this. And we've got to quit crucifying Jesus and join in the crowd and you know, always thinking that right and wrong is what it's about, when Christ is what it's about. But we only know a message. We couldn't spot him if he walked up and bled on us. All right. There is no examination of the inward parts. And we're still accepted. You know what? Those people are all accepted over all those years, you know. They just missed Jesus, not in doctrine, not in faith when they first accepted him. They missed Jesus in the practical living reality. They got a chance to fellowship with him in these things, in a sweet savor offering, and they missed it. And they made it all, everything's always about a sin offering. Well, you're in sin, so this is it. This is what this is about. It's always about crucifying somebody. It's always about killing something that sinned. See, instead of releasing Christ. He knows the death and may know of the wisdom behind it, the head of the dove. One of the special features involved with the doves is the crop of the bird was cast away. Now, the truth is it wasn't cast away. It was put on the east side of the altar where the ashes are, and I'm not going to get into all that, but if you want to examine that, you can see it in the offering of the red heifer. You can see it in the consecration of the priests, this east side of the altar, this ashes area where everything that is burned up is not dumped and cast away, meaning thrown away. That's the way some commentators I read, that's what they got out of it. Well, the head of the offering is thrown away. Well, the ashes are all just thrown away. No, they're put on the east side of the altar, and when the sun comes up, the resurrection light hits them first, because they've been reduced down to the lowest of what they are, and they've released Christ to the highest degree. When resurrection comes, that day dawn, that day star hits them first on that east side. There's more to it, but since it is thrown, the head is thrown away, there's little connection with the mind of Christ, only acceptance of what he did for us. And so I'm just going to stop right there. But there is this thought that there is, God, how do you say it? You can almost say there is a natural mind, which is the mind of flesh before we came to the Lord. So we get saved, and we get a carnal mind, which is not necessarily bad, because Paul said, are you not carnal even as unto babes in Christ, which means that that mind is someone in Christ, and it's someone who has been born into the family. It's not necessarily wrong. It just hasn't matured. It'd be like saying just kids in general are wrong. You know, well, they're just little brats, are just selfish. Little punks, you know, and just somebody ought to just slap kids every time they see them. Everybody ought to do that. They just, until they mature. Well, I don't really like that idea. I think we ought to love them. And I think we ought to love them until they do mature. And you know what? If they're not mature, if the church isn't mature, that's the responsibility of those who think they are. Ought to be getting out there and maturing them. You know what I mean? Helping them to grow up. You know, not condemning them. And I know if somebody sticks their heels in the ground and says, well, you know, I don't want nothing to do with the cross or anything. Well, then that's between them and God. Now now the issue is not the things I just talked about. Kick the dust off your shoes and go to somebody that's open. But it's still not over with them. God didn't, once you kick the dust off, God didn't say, that's it, I'll never deal with them again. Did anybody hear what I just said? We always think, well, you know, there's some sort of attitude. Well, I'll just shake the dust off of my shoes on you and, you know, that's it. Yeah. Folks, God is merciful to the last minute. He never gives up on anybody. Say, well, I made a mistake. I did some bad stuff. I sinned. I got off. you're a rare person. Most of us stay right on all the time. You know? And I'm joking. You know? Most people are off some way, somehow. If you knew how everybody in this room was off, you'd just get up and leave and never come back. You would. You'd just get up and leave and never, ever come back. And then you'd go to another church where you could be blissfully blind until God, if he opened your eyes to all their offness, then you go, oh my God, are we all just messed up? And then, you know, you're supposed to go, gee, I think I was taught that in Bible school. We are all messed up, and why am I freaking out over that? We just should get after seeing Jesus and conforming to him. You know, and you go, maybe that dead burnt school did have something from the Lord for me. Maybe. Well, let's stand together and close out. Normally I don't have you stand, but you may be ready to run out the room now. Before I pray, I would like to say I am very proud of all of you for even acting like you're interested in what I've shared this class, because the stuff that I've shared is strong meat. Now, there's stuff for everybody in it, but it's strong meat and hard to digest. And you guys have really done well, and I mean, you really have in so many fronts, and I'm just proud of you. And my intention, I felt like the Lord told me, because I've had a lot of this for a while, but I felt like the Lord told me to share this now. Not because you're all mature enough to get everything that's being shared, but that for whatever reason he wanted this down on tape or whatever for the future or whatever, but that he wanted me to share it, but that your hearts were different than some others in that it could fall in the ground like seeds. And that if it was years and years and years later, and you didn't know where it sprang from, not that it matters, and it doesn't, the truth would rise in you and fill you, and there would be a level of truth and reality that would just fill you with joy to know. So I'm sorry that it seemed maybe even to some degree boring or tedious or whatever. But I felt like I was following the Lord and obeying the Lord and doing this. And I trust him that it will bear fruit in your lives for in years to come. So please receive my apology for what seemed like just, you know, almost like, you know, one way they torture people is they make them drink a lot of water. They just keep pouring, you know. And so you may have felt like, oh my God, I'm being tortured. I've watched a bunch of the class sit here, and about 15 minutes into it, I'd shared so much, you shut down for the rest of the 45 minutes and the hour that followed. And that's okay. I mean, really, I understand that. There is no way that you could get it. I've spent, you know, 35 years getting this. How are you going to get it in a few classes? It's just not going to happen. Not get it instantly, knowing everything and all of it. You got what the Lord wanted you to have. You did. You got what the Lord wanted you to have, and you'll get more later on. My reason for even saying anything is a sincere thank you for sticking with it and, you know, not just totally blocking me out, you know, because I don't sense that you did that. So thank you. Father, I just thank you for these that have gathered here, and I thank you for their heart for you. So we put these seeds into your hands, Jesus. And we trust you with the future and the results. And we love you, and we love you together. Together, we just say, Jesus, you're just the best. Father, you're just the best father we could ever have. And Holy Spirit, you're the best guide, and you're the best teacher, and the best friend someone on this planet could ever have. Thank you. We love you. Dismiss us now and continue to move in our lives. Thank you for the work that was done in the class before, Lord. Thank you for helping us on all kinds of levels. We sense your love and your care, and we sense your divine preparation for the future. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. We're dismissed.